lamentablemente por ahora.
Behind these banners, if you have a placard, if you're here for the rally, why? Because we're going to take photos. We're going to show and counter this media narrative that nobody supports. Even in the U.S., we support the Venezuelan Revolution because we know what this country has done throughout the world and what it's doing to its own people. Compañeros, compañeras, les estamos pidiendo un favor si están aquí para el mitin. Que hagan el favor de venir hacia acá porque y se juntan con nosotros aquí en el mitin para mostrar el amplio apoyo que se encuentra aquí en la misión de la revolución bolivariana, porque lo estamos enfrentando a una guerra mediática. Es una guerra sucia de mentiras y nosotros estamos diciendo hoy en día que estamos con la revolución bolivariana, que estamos con el proceso del pueblo en Venezuela. Entonces, favor, les tomen fotos. Por favor, pongan en el Facebook. Por favor, pongan en Twitter. Que esto, aquí en la misión, hay apoyo. Mi nombre es Frank Lara, soy parte de la coalición Answer y Balas. Y hay muchos grupos que vinieron hoy, Task Force for the School of the America's Watch. También tuvimos el Center for Political Education. Tuvimos de nuevo Balas, FMLN, diferentes grupos. Tuvimos también Task Force in the Americas, Marcha Patriótica de Colombia, y el Círculo Bolivariano de Venezuela aquí en Área de la Bahía. So, brothers and sisters, there's a number of groups here today, and we're going to start this with speeches. You'll hear people from different backgrounds starting to talk on the issue of Venezuela. So, welcome, welcome. We'll start with a real quick chant. We'll start with Chavez Vive. Y Maduro sigue. Ready? Chávez vive! Chávez vive! Maduro sigue! Chávez vive! Chávez vive! Chávez vive! El otro, un clásico, el pueblo unido jamás será vencido. ¿Listo? El pueblo jamás será vencido. El pueblo jamás será vencido. El pueblo jamás será vencido. Unidos. Okay, brothers and sisters, we're just going to have opening rallies, discussions from different people. And again, why we support the Venezuelan Revolution, I'll have Caro, compañera MC today, co-MC, introduce yourself.
En español, bueno, en español. Hola a todos, mi nombre es Carolina Morales y yo soy venezolana que resido acá hace unos años. Acabo de regresar de Venezuela hace dos semanas, tuve el gran privilegio de ir y quedarme allá por seis semanas y de ver de verdad la belleza de nuestro pueblo en Venezuela y de ver todo el cambio muy hermoso que ha estado dándose allá. Gracias también al liderazgo y el apoyo del gobierno venezolano, en estos momentos el presidente Nicolás Maduro, que democráticamente fue electo ahora el 14 de abril de este año. Entonces le damos acá la bienvenida del pasado. Ay, ya estamos en el 2014, gracias por recordarnos. Entonces les damos la bienvenida acá, muchas gracias por venir, muchas gracias por la solidaridad que le dan al pueblo venezolano, por estar acá pronunciándose por la paz, por la dignidad, sin ningún tipo de agresiones. Como pueden ver en los medios de comunicación, la derecha sigue mintiendo, sigue diciendo que la izquierda es violenta, que la izquierda está creando destrucción, cuando sabemos que la realidad es que sus mismos sectores de la ultraderecha están creando toda esa violencia, están tratando de desestabilizar un gobierno que lo que ha hecho es trabajar. No podemos aceptar eso, tenemos que estar aquí como lo estamos haciendo hoy día y continuemos difundiendo la verdad acerca de lo que ocurre en Caracas, acerca de lo que ocurre en Venezuela. Yo tendré un evento el 6 de marzo y espero verlos a todos allá. Si quieren más información, Hay algunos panfletos acá en la mesa. Muchísimas gracias y bienvenido. Now I have to remember that in English. So, hello everybody, my name is Carolina Morales and I am part of a couple of collectives here. I'm part of the Center for Political Education and also the Bolivarian Circle of the Northern California. And I am here because I am Venezuelan and I just came back from Venezuela 2 weeks ago and I was there for 6 weeks. And I was there witnessing the labor that our people have been doing down there to continue our fight for economic justice, for racial justice. There is really such a beauty in the labor that's going on there, and I'm really upset and really saddened that right now there are sectors in the ultra-right that are creating so much violence and that are trying to destabilize the country and destabilize the government in order to affect in some way the peace that is going on in Venezuela. And we can't allow that. That's why we're here. That's why I thank you all and continue to invite you to continue doing this labor of supporting Venezuela from here, from the U.S., because I know that the people of the U.S. want justice and want dignity in the same way that the people of Venezuela want it. So I hope that you can invite more friends. We can continue distributing the truth through any means that we can, talking to our friends, posting on Facebook, on Twitter, like Frank was saying earlier. And let's continue sharing the truth of what is going on with the Bolivarian Revolution. Do not believe the lies of private media, corporate media, that is just trying to say that the left in Venezuela is creating chaos when it's the right. Thank you.
Thank you, Caro. And again, we're just introducing speakers. First speaker is Gloria Larriba from the Party for Socialism and Liberation. Please welcome Gloria.
Sisters and brothers, we're facing a very serious situation in Venezuela with the outright call by right-wing leader Leopoldo López, who is the leader of the Voluntad Popular Party in Venezuela. On February 12th, he called for the people to come out into the street to overturn the government. And now he's in hiding because there's an arrest order for causing violence in the population. Three people have died, dozens have been injured, and armed gangs are still threatening the population. And yesterday, U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry, who is always traveling around the world to interfere in other people's affairs, he demanded that the arrest order of Leopoldo López be terminated and to free the demonstrators that have caused the violence, the anti-government demonstrators. And then yesterday in Washington, D.C., the Alex Lee, who is a representative of the U.S. State Department, called the Venezuelan ambassador into the office of the Organization of American States, which is really dictated to by the U.S. And he ordered the Venezuelan ambassador, he said, the Venezuelan people must dialogue with the opposition. You must cancel the arrest order of Leopoldo López, and among other things. That is the most arrogant demand of the United States government at a time when 18 referendums and elections in that country for the last 15 years have proven popular majority support for a revolutionary change, something that we need here. While the government builds hundreds of thousands of houses and promises 7 million new homes for the people, which will be given to the people, we in the mission are being evicted because of land developers and speculators, and we have a lesson to learn from what's going on in Venezuela. The Venezuelan government, for the fourth year in a row, is giving heating oil to the poor, including Indian reservations, cities like Boston, New York, Chicago, people who freeze to death if they didn't have the help of Venezuela. So we say, our sisters and brothers are in a revolutionary struggle, and we back them 100%, and we're proud to be here, every one of us. The other is that yesterday, while Washington was dictating to Venezuela, the anti-coalition, the FMLN, and community groups of Washington, D.C., held a protest in front of the Venezuelan embassy to protect and defend the embassy, while 150 right-wingers, violent, vicious, racist, anti-worker people in luxury cars with little dogs, pedigree dogs, and little outfits, fancy outfits, while they sat in their cars and took turns. We stood out there for 6 hours and outlasted the right wing, and they weren't able to take over the Venezuelan embassy. The people here are in solidarity. We're in solidarity around the world. Chavez vive en el pueblo. Y la lucha sigue. Y estamos aquí. Y no nos moverá.
Gracias, Gloria. De nuevo, comunidad, la misión, porque estamos aquí es para contradecir las mentiras que están saliendo en nuestros propios periódicos, en nuestros propios medios. Estamos diciendo que sí hay justicia en Venezuela, que los que no respetan la justicia es la derecha, que usa el terrorismo, que usa la violencia para que saquen su propaganda. Y eso es triste, porque como ya no pueden ganar elecciones, ¿qué es lo que está haciendo? Violencia, eso es estrategia. Our next speaker, as we said, there's a number of groups out here. One of the groups really supportive of the struggle is the School of the Americas Watch. And we have a speaker, Dale Swartzen. She's going to mention a little about how those things are connected.
Hi, we are part of the School of the Americas Watch, but actually I'm the Task Force of the Americas based in Marin. We're a solidarity group that's been around since the mid-80s. And we have taken numerous delegations to Venezuela since, I think our first one was in 2004. And I and several of us that are here today are going down again in 2 weeks. But every time that I've gone there, I've just been amazed at all the positive things that I see going on. And of course, the right wing in the country, the opposition, as well as the U.S. government, doesn't want people to know these things that are going on, like, for instance, poverty alleviation, for instance, free health care, for instance, the ability to be able to go to university. All those things I've seen, I've heard, I've seen the Cuban doctors there administering health care. It's just an amazing thing that's going on there, the Bolivarian Revolution, the process that's going on. Yes, there are some problems. Yes, there probably is too much crime on the streets, but tell me a country that doesn't have street crime, And then I just want to say, because I was recently in Honduras and wrote a little article in our newsletter that contrasts the response of the U.S. government to the elections in Honduras versus the elections in Venezuela. And I think for those of you that are in this loop, you know what I'm talking about. It's amazing. In Honduras, talk about corruption. It's the murder capital of the world, and yet the U.S. government, and there's quite a few people here who monitored the election, the U.S. government, the ambassador there, recognized this government within hours of the polls closing, saying that it was transparent and wonderful. When it came to Venezuela last April, I was there also, Venezuela's system has been praised by the Carter Center, by many people, by the National Lawyers Guild, as being one of the, if we could have an electoral system like Venezuela does, we'd be in much better shape. And that election was impeccable. And yet the U.S. government sided with the opposition, demanding an unreasonable recount of ballots that were statistically impossible for there to be a change. And I think one of the most important things that we can do now is demand from our government the recognition of Nicolas Maduro as the president of Venezuela now, because they have not done it.
Thank you so much for your words. Muchas gracias por sus palabras. Ahorita quiero introducir a una compañera, presentar a una compañera, Morelia, que es una compañera de El Salvador y que ha estado muy al pendiente de lo que está ocurriendo con las elecciones de El Salvador, y como sabemos, apoyamos desde Venezuela la democracia en El Salvador y el camino que sigue tomando hacia la humanidad y ayudar al pueblo, y este amor que le tenemos nosotros al pueblo, ¿no? And so I want to introduce Comrade Morelia, who's from El Salvador and who has been following the elections in El Salvador and is also about to travel there, and who knows what's the connection between what's been going on in Venezuela and what El Salvador has been fighting for as well, in this love for humanity, this love for the people, this love for making sure that all of us can have access to basic needs. Thank you, Morelia.
Buenas tardes. Creo que Caro ya dijo como la mitad de lo que yo iba a decir, pero bueno, como dijo, soy Morelia, yo estoy aquí independientemente, pero trabajo bastante con CISPES, el Comité de Solidaridad con el Pueblo de El Salvador. He viajado ya varias veces a partir del 2011, cuando CISPES empezó a enfocarse bastante. Sabemos, ¿verdad?, que CISPES ha estado trabajando en solidaridad con el pueblo salvadoreño ya desde 1980, pero a partir de la elección del primer gobierno del FMLN, en el 2009, uno de nuestros enfoques ha sido ver cuáles son los cambios, ¿verdad?, que se están dando en El Salvador. I'm going to try to do this in Spanish and English for those of you who might not be bilingual. And also for all of you out in the street who might be able to hear me right now, I think this is really important because I imagine that I'm in company of compañeros who already know a lot of what I want to share, right? I'm here with the Committee in Solidarity with the People of El Salvador as a member of CISPES, and in solidarity with the people of Venezuela. Part of the reason that I'm here is because I understand what it means to have a need for democratization processes. Estoy aquí porque entiendo la necesidad de los procesos de democratización. I am an immigrant to the United States. Soy inmigrante, yo vine durante la guerra, fui parte del éxodo de la guerra civil de El Salvador, y entiendo la necesidad, ¿verdad?, de este proceso de democratización, y precisamente estamos viviendo eso en El Salvador. Currently in El Salvador, this process of democratization is very present, right? We are coming out of the first FMLN government, currently right now we're going into the second round of elections in El Salvador, and during the first round, Salvador Sánchez Serén, who was the candidate for the FMLN, won. He didn't win the percentage majority that's required by law, so we have to go to second round. Anyway, the point is that part of the reason why it's so important for me to be here is that I know that democratization processes in Latin America and all over the world are always under attack, and this is why I'm going to El Salvador, because I'm going to be an official elections observer during the second round of elections. And Venezuela is an example of that kind of democratization, right, that we want. And it's clear that this is another attempt at another coup, at a rolling coup that's been happening for years. Estoy aquí en solidaridad con el pueblo venezolano precisamente porque vemos que Venezuela es un gran ejemplo de lo que se puede hacer cuando se aboga por el pueblo. Y bueno, no sé, podría seguir, pero no sé qué más decir. Estén al pendiente de lo que sucede en El Salvador el 9 de marzo. Elections in El Salvador are on March 9th, the second round of elections, and please be in solidarity there too, because we never know what kinds of attempts at electoral fraud. Well, we do know, right? Que viva Venezuela, que viva Chávez.
¡Que viva la revolución bolivariana!
Gracias, compañera. De nuevo, ahí va a pasar gente y están preguntando por qué tenemos tanta gente de oradores que vienen de otros países. Porque lo que estamos hablando es que estamos hablando de una América Latina unida. Una América Latina que se haya unido alrededor del proyecto de Venezuela y de Cuba. Y vamos a seguir con esa temática. Brothers and sisters, some people walking by have been asking, why are so many speakers from other countries? Well, because what we're talking about is a Latin America that's united. A Latin America that's united around Venezuela and Cuba. So we're continuing with that theme with our next speaker, Alice from Marcha Patriótica de Colombia, de California.
Bueno, voy a empezar con esto, que me parece muy importante. ¡Alerta! ¡Alerta! ¡Alerta que camina! ¡La espada de Bolívar por América Latina! ¡Alerta! ¡Alerta! ¡Alerta que camina! ¡La espada de Bolívar por América Latina! ¡Alerta! ¡Alerta! ¡Alerta que camina! ¡La espada de Bolívar por América Latina! Good morning, good afternoon, everybody. Nice to see you here. I work in a coalition in Colombia called Marcha Patriótica. It's a broad coalition of resistance that's taken many, many years to build. And after the 90s and the beginnings of the 2000s and the repression in Colombia, the mass killings, the mass displacements, people disappearing, it's been very, very difficult to build a resistance and to build something that looks like a national movement. And one of the reasons that we've been able to do that was because the star next door supported us. It's hard to even tell you how important Venezuela has been for the resistance in Colombia and all of Latin America. It's been a support that is unbelievable. In Colombia, we have had so much repression. We now have 11,000 political prisoners. We're trying to negotiate peace in Cuba. Venezuela supported us, Chavez supported us, and the Venezuelan Bolivarianos have supported us all the way through it. We've had many, many meetings in Venezuela that we could not have in Colombia. We've been invited to participate with other Latin American countries in resistance in Venezuela. We could not do it in Colombia. We've had many, many people exiled in Venezuela, but many, many thousands of people exiled in Venezuela that have been received by the Venezuelan government because they would be killed in Colombia. And that's why it goes on and on what Venezuela has done for us. Not only for us, the support they've given for Ecuador, the support they've given for the Peruvian resistance, the support they've given for the Argentinian resistance, the Brazilian, it's incredible what Venezuela has been. There are many people in Latin America who are struggling and resisting, and one of the main resistances is the U.S. intervention. The right wing in Venezuela has developed only because the United States has supported it and funded it. The same as in Colombia. The United States has supported and funded and put in 7 military bases in Colombia. 7 U.S. military bases in Colombia, why? It's a trampoline, and it's a trampoline planning the invasion of Venezuela in any minute, any given minute, and they'll do it. So it's important to support Venezuela, it's important to support all the resistance of Latin America, and it's important to build and be the resistance in this country, which is the biggest and most impressive. Thank you.
Our next speaker is from a country also that has had a lot of social movements and that is often ignored by the U.S. media, the way it distorts Venezuelan media, information from Venezuela, so too does the U.S. distort information from
1805. And in a few years later, Simon Bolivar came to Haiti. Haiti had been forced itself out of colonialism and had become an independent country. And Brother Bolivar came to my hometown in Lecai, where he was warmly received by the people, and there is still a statue of him. Was a child I used to play under the statue of Bolivar. So right at the place where he landed. I'm going back over this to tell you that we are historically linked with the people of Venezuela. And the people of Haiti at that time, volunteers went with Simon Bolivar and fought against Spanish colonialism. and brothers and sisters in Venezuela were freed after many years of struggle. So when the people of Venezuela win, we win in Haiti. 10 years ago, there was a coup d'etat orchestrated by the Bush administration and by the right-wing forces in the U.S. against the people of Haiti. And it happened on February 29th against President Aristide. The people of Venezuela and comrade Hugo Chavez stood up as one and said they were opposed to the coup and they refused to recognize the coup government, which the many other countries were recognizing. So please clap for the people of Venezuela. They stood on principle, they stood with us, and they refused to recognize any other president but President Aristide of Haiti. The people of Cuba did the same, and so did CARICOM, the Caribbean community, all the countries in CARICOM. And so we feel very deeply in our heart that the struggle of the people of Venezuela is linked with the struggle of the people of Haiti. What is the struggle about? It's about justice. It's about social and economic justice. It's about democracy. It's about the resources of the country. The oil, Haiti has oil also. Haiti has gold and silver and all those, and copper. It's about those resources, same as the people of Venezuela are demanding that their resources be used for themselves to eliminate poverty, to eliminate misery, to eliminate unemployment, to give the students access to education. That's what it's all about. That's what the struggle is in Haiti. So this morning, as I was speaking to brothers and sisters in Haiti, they have asked me to convey their strong solidarity in this time of crisis with the people of Venezuela. And they stand with the brothers and sisters throughout Latin America who are standing strong against the right-wing war against the people in the countries of the Americas. And also here as well, people are attacking people, the majority people in this country, the right-wing forces. So we need to stand very strong. So I just wanted to express this solidarity with you and to let you know that we stand very strongly with the people of Venezuela and call on us at any time, and we'll be there, we'll mobilize. Your solidarity, the solidarity of the people of the United States, is so crucial, it's so vital, it's so important in order to stop the right-wing elements that are in control of this country from killing and disappearing and murdering people who are simply demanding their rights to have the decision, to have decision making in what's going on in their land and what's affecting their everyday life. So thank you to the Answer Coalition. Thank you to all the organizations that are so beautiful in recognizing our common solidarity and to put an end to oppression. It has to be global, it has to be worldwide. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, Pierre. Viva Haiti! Leave Haiti in the struggling Haiti. So once again, my name is Carolina Morales, and I am part of the Center for Political Education and the Bolivarian Circle of the Northern California. And it's my pleasure to introduce another organizer in the community who's been really fighting for the rights of people here in San Francisco.
Se ha ido asesinando a tantas gentes por los carteles de drogas que han encontrado en Estados Unidos. Ahora tiene conexión directa con muchos de los carteles. Entonces vamos a hablar un poquito sobre este tema del compañero Gato de Yo Soy 132 del área de la Bahía. Gracias, compañeros. Nosotros los mexicanos tenemos una larga historia de la memoria del imperialismo de este país. Parte de nuestro territorio fue robado y seguimos día a día sufriendo ese imperialismo yanqui. Esta semana Obama va a mandar al presidente mexicano, que salió en la revista Time diciendo que es el salvador de México. Sus contactos con el cartel de Chapo Guzmán han garantizado que en México haya más de 100,000 muertos. 100,000 muertos, compañeros, sería la décima parte de San Francisco. Y en México las noticias se callan. Compañías como la CNC y las televisoras norteamericanas siguen callando eso. Nosotros los mexicanos tenemos que estar aquí en la calle pasando películas para que ustedes sepan que en México estamos en una guerra civil y las armas las provee este país. Al igual que en Venezuela, el dinero lo provee este país. Curiosamente, en este país no hay golpes de Estado, compañeros, porque no hay embajada gringa aquí. Pero en nuestros países, la extensión del gobierno gringo son esos consulados gringos que solo sirven para promover la destrucción y el odio. Decía un gran revolucionario mexicano, el maestro José Revueltas, ¿por qué hay obreros y campesinos que luchan contra sus intereses? Parece ser que nos robaron la cabeza y nos pusieron otra. José Revueltas decía así: en México, los obreros y campesinos y estudiantes luchan contra los socialistas y los comunistas. Bueno, compañeros, es momento de despertar, ir tocando puertas, conocernos y abrazarnos los que luchamos para que quitar a estos compañeritos que a veces ven mucha televisión y que es mucho los comerciales de Televisa que todo está perfecto, porque no está perfecto. ¿Quién putas va a vivir con $8 en esta ciudad cuando las rentas de una casa son $2,000? ¿Quién va a poder vivir cuando no podemos manejar a nuestros trabajos, cuando nuestros hijos se endeudan para salir a la universidad? Compañeros, lo que pasa en Venezuela, están luchando por algo mejor. No sabemos si van por el buen camino, pero sabemos que están luchando y eso garantiza la victoria. Hoy, compañeros, en México también estamos haciendo lo mismo. No negamos que somos poquitos, no negamos que cometemos errores. Lo que sí negamos es a rendirnos. Así que, compas, en las calles y en los barrios de Venezuela hay que echar para adelante, lo mismo que en los barrios de la Misión y en México. Compañeros, al igual que Michoacán, Chiapas y aquí en la Misión, hay que echar para adelante. Muchas gracias, compas.
Gracias, hermano. Brothers and sisters, again, why it's important to be out here. We're going to be wrapping up this rally, which is a very successful rally. You saw all the media attention that's coming out. We're not talking, when we talk about international media, we're talking about Reuters, AP, Associated Press, but these are the channels that are spreading the lies. Even locally, people want to know what's really going on. And so if we don't come out and do these type of actions, you just hear
what... And that's what our struggle is, to present the reality, the truth. The Answer Coalition expresses support for the Venezuelan people, for Maduro, for the Bolivarian Revolution, and we condemn attempts at destabilizing, attempts to overthrow the Venezuelan government. And again, make no mistakes about it. This is not a movement about democracy. This is not about people wanting to express their opinions. This is a movement of the privileged wanting to maintain their privileges, wanting to expand their privileges. Their problem is that the Bolivarian Revolution has managed to give some of the resources of society to the working class, to working people, to the poor. Conditions of the working, of living conditions of the working people in Venezuela has really improved. And the U.S. government and the elite strata of all societies are very much opposed to that. We can see that, you know, there's consistency in what the U.S. government does around the world. In all of Latin America, why is it, as Brother Pierre was explaining, why is it that the U.S. orchestrated a coup in Haiti 10 years ago? Was it about democracy? No, Aristide has been elected democratically. Why is it that they're trying to overthrow the state in Venezuela after 15, 16 elections and referenda? Is it that they're not democratically elected? No, there's ample evidence that they were democratically elected. But from the U.S. perspective, what counts as democracy is the privileged sectors of society getting all their resources. And the privileged sectors actually help funnel the resources of society to the U.S. banks and corporations. That's what it's about. That's why they've been trying to overthrow Cuba for half a century. That's why they supported the coup in everywhere, whether you think of Chile or whether you think of all of the other attempts that they're making to overthrow any state that exercises some national control.
some level of support for their people. From the U.S. perspective, everything should go to the banks and to the corporations. Every obstacle along that way should be removed. It doesn't matter whether they were elected or not elected. And we can see that. How do we know that there's consistency? Look at what happened in the great recession here in the U.S. The U.S. government jumped to the rescue of the banks, billions and billions of dollars, gave it to them to save them. What did they do for working people? Well, initially nothing, and then they started cutting all the programs that give some little relief to the working people. Again, it's the same model. The resources of the society, as far as the U.S. government is concerned, should go to the banks, to the corporations, to the elite. And this is a common thread in the U.S. Domination, in the U.S. intervention around the world, not just in Latin America, but around the world. In that sense, the right wing, the privileged, the elite are united through the support of the U.S., and we, the people's movement, have to be united as well. We have to continue to support the Venezuelan people. We have to continue to support Cuba. We have to continue to support the left wing shift in Latin America, which is providing some benefits to working people. And we have to oppose attempts by the U.S. for coups, for civil wars, for other things that they are supporting the right wings in to bring the privileged sectors of society in power, and it's all packaged under the name of democracy. So let's express solidarity to the people of Venezuela, express solidarity to the people of all of Latin America, which have formed a united front against the American, against the U.S. imperialism, and let's express solidarity for the people of the world to express their right of self-determination against U.S. intervention. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Maza, for that. And again, we're activists, organizers, people who are also interested just in humanity and in justice in the world. And so there's just a shout out from one of the person attending, talking about that it's just not the U.S. imperialism, but also British imperialism and what it's done for certain countries. And the brother wanted to mention all these political prisoners that are still found in Ireland, and Ireland's struggle for determination, self-determination, and we want to always remember that this is the same strategy. What happened in Syria, what happened in Libya, that's what they want. They happened in Venezuela, you cause chaos, you cause terror, and then you come and invade. So we're going to be wrapping up. Compañera Caro is going to lead us in a chant. Please, again, join us. We want to end this really strong. Take a picture and show your solidarity. It's so important. You have no idea how important it is for Venezuelans to see that in the U.S., the poor, the workers, the people who are conscious and are justice-oriented know on which side to stand. So please welcome Caro. Vamos a terminar con este mitin.
Thank you, everybody, once again for being here, for supporting Venezuelan sovereignty. I am a Venezuelan living here in San Francisco, and it's an honor for me to be with all of you. And as in Venezuela, they're talking about Latin America as nuestra America, our America. And that's how we have to think about this. We're all connected, and we need to continue fighting together, fighting for democracy, fighting for real independence, the independence that Venezuela has been able to obtain thanks to the Bolivarian Revolution. So I invite you all to come on March 6th to the Center for Political Education's event called Un Año de la Siembra de Chávez. And this is an event that we're doing both as a report back of my trip to Venezuela that I just came back from 2 weeks ago, as well as a way to honor Hugo Chávez, his legacy, and the fact that we lost his body, or we lost him physically on March 5th, but all of his vision, all of his politics, all of his legacy, and all of the ways that he inspired us continues to be alive today, and it's stronger than ever. So we're going to have two chants. The first one is Chávez vive, Maduro sigue. And we'll repeat it three times, and then we'll have another chant, yeah? So Chávez vive, Maduro sigue. Chávez vive, Maduro sigue. Chávez vive, Maduro sigue. And then the other one is a little longer, right? But it's one that you all know. It's alerta. The most important one. We need to be very alert to this imperialist attack from the U.S. that's being solo in concubinato with the right in Venezuela. So, alerta, ¿cómo es? Alerta, alerta, alerta que camina la espada de Bolívar por América Latina. Alerta, alerta, alerta que camina la espada de Bolívar por América Latina. Alerta, alerta, alerta que camina la espada de Bolívar por América Latina. Thank you.
Thanks everyone for coming out again. Two events, also March 5th here on 24th, we're going to have a vigil and a memory of the first year of Chavez's passing, so please come out. March 6th, again, Center for Political Education having an education session. Please get some flyers. We also have additional events, but come out to March 5th. We're going to be talking about also the recent freedom of Fernando, one of the Cuban Five, so please come out. Come out and support. Thank you.